as we finish greeting one another in the Lord and move towards our seats, I want to welcome you to Emmanuel Presbyterian Church. My name is Deren, pastor here. Very grateful for your presence with us today. Particularly if you're visiting today, you'll see in the seat pocket in front of you, there's a white visitor's card. If you would take a moment, you could fill out that card, let us know a little bit more about you. As the offering plate comes by, you can put the card in the offering plate, or I'll be glad to greet you and take that card from you after our service is concluded. Thank you so much for visiting with us this morning. By way of announcements, if you'd open your bulletin to page 16, allow me to draw your attention to a few of the announcements that are there. First, I want to just remind us for further reflection this week, our monthly scripture memory verse is Ephesians 4, 1 through 3, which says, "I therefore, as a prisoner of the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace." And then our reflection for this week out of the New City Catechism, question 33. Those who have faith in Christ seek their salvation through their own works or anywhere else? No, they should not, as everything necessary to salvation is found in Christ. To seek salvation through good works is a denial that Christ is the only Redeemer and Savior. So just things to ponder and to think about and to reflect further on this week. Secondly, want to encourage us to come back next Sunday night, obviously for Sunday morning worship, but next Sunday night we're going to have our summer sing night, an opportunity to gather as the family of God to praise and to sing with one another. In addition to that, next Sunday night there'll be a trip report and testimonies from our missions project to West Virginia, and so an opportunity to come that evening as a family and join us in song, but also where we'll hear good news through those that were part of that project in West Virginia. And so I want to encourage you to put on your calendars to be with us next Sunday night. On page 17 and 18, you can begin to see details in the announcements that relate to growth opportunities that are coming this fall. Most of those will begin, they do begin after Labor Day. And so our encouragement to you at this season is to be praying, to be asking God where you could plug in to grow in faith and to grow with others this coming fall. And so you can see the announcement there of various opportunities and contact information for those who will be facilitating and leading those groups. And if you have a question that's not answered in the announcement, you're always free to ask me, and I'll either try to answer it or point you in the right direction. So note that. Today, note that there is no college lunch today, so College Plus lunch is not gathering today. It won't gather again till the 28th, and so make sure that you pay attention to that as many of our college students have returned or are returning to their various campuses in this week and the coming weeks. Last but not least, Kids Hope, IPC Mentor Program. Many have participated in that program this past year. What that is we have adult members of our congregation who volunteer to be a mentor to an elementary kid. And so once a week or so, they'll go over to George Marks Elementary School and spend time with a young man or a young lady and an opportunity to develop friendship and an opportunity to use those means as an opportunity to talk about the hope that we have in Christ. So those that have participated and are looking to participate again this coming year, or if you're interested in being a volunteer mentor, there's a meeting on the 28th immediately after the worship service. You reach out to Bree Gutierrez for more information or let her know that you're coming. And so that is a ministry, an opportunity to serve our community through that mentoring program. With that, that concludes our announcements. Let me pray for us, and then we'll stand for our call to worship. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for bringing us here today. Father, we thank you for your goodness to us this week. We thank you that your mercies are new every morning. We thank you for your faithfulness. Great is your faithfulness to us as your people. And so, Father, now we ask that you would take our minds and take our hearts, and Father, would you turn them towards yourself? Would you help us to declare the wonders of your great name this morning as your people? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please stand this morning for our call to worship. Our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 103. I'll read the light print. Please respond in unison with the bold. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits.
Who forgives all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies you with good, so that your youth is renewed like an eagle's.
The Lord works righteousness and justice for all who are oppressed. He made known his ways to Moses, his acts to the people of Israel.
The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love.
He will not always chide, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities.
For in his eyes,
bless the Lord, O you his angels, you mighty ones who do his word, obeying the voice of his word. Bless the Lord, all his hosts, his ministers, who do his will. Bless the Lord, all his works, in all places of his dominion. Bless the Lord, O my soul.
Come now to our affirmation of faith, which today comes from the Heidelberg Catechism, questions 12 through 15. I just want to share a little. I had a conversation with Daniel Heartless, wherever he is. Is Daniel here? Daniel's not here. Okay. I saw the Heartlesses come in. Last week, we were at the College Plus, and I made a claim. My claim was that we can have intellectual confidence in our faith, that we should not be embarrassed by the world or challenged or feel defensive. He was struck by that. I feel very challenged. And so we met during the week and we had some discussion about it. And one of the aspects that we talked about many, and don't get me wrong, I don't think I can prove to an agnostic that the gospel is true. But I was an engineer. I love logic. And I have come to see the beauty of the gospel. And so as we read the Heidelberg Catechism today, marvel at how it's logical. Marvel at how sensible it is. And yet Scripture tells us that it is foolishness to those who are perishing. And so it's one small example. The unbelieving world has no explanation for that. How can something be foolishness to some and logic to others that appreciate logic? And I was converted as an adult. It was foolishness to me 1 week. It was logical the next week. So as we do this, and then the other one that just struck me to actually say this was, in our assurance of pardon, the Lord says to us, come, let us reason together about our salvation. So as we go through this, just be in awe of the Lord's work. I will read the question if you will respond with the answer. Question 12. Since, according to God's righteous judgment, we deserve temporal and eternal punishment, how can we escape this punishment and be again received into favor? God demands that his justice be satisfied. Therefore, full payment must be made either by ourselves or by another. Can we ourselves make this payment? Certainly not. On the contrary, we daily increase our debt. Can we, any mere creature pay for us? No. In the first place, God will not punish another creature for the sin which man has committed. Furthermore, no mere creature can sustain the burden of God's eternal wrath against sin and deliver others from it. So what kind of mediator and deliverer must we seek? One who is a true and righteous man, and yet more powerful than all creatures, that is, one who is at the same time true God. Please join me in our corporate prayer of confession, which will be followed by a time of silent confession. Almighty Father, I confess my spiritual pride. I still believe the myths of my own goodness, that my obedience can compensate for my disobedience, that I'm better than others, if not all, at least some, that there are sins I'm not capable of committing, that I can manage temptation in my own strength. I make my confession in Jesus' name. Amen. Heavenly Father, Lord, I confess that even though I know the truth, Lord, you show me my sin daily, there's a part of me, Lord, that wants to solve the problem myself, to make up for my failures. And yet, Lord, as we see in the Catechism, you demand perfect obedience because you are perfect. And so, Father, we thank you and praise you, Lord, that it is not our work, it is not our doing that saves us, that has any part of it, Lord. We only bring our sin to the table. We praise you and thank you for the Lord Jesus, that he was willing to substitute himself, perfect man, for our record. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Our assurance of pardon comes from the book of Isaiah, chapter 1, verse 18, and 1 Peter, chapter 3, verses 18. Come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall become like wool. And how could that happen? 1 Peter. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit. Thanks be to God.
Please stand as we now sing Rock of Ages.
Thank you.
We come now to our pastoral prayer, where we'll pray for our IPC family, for Julian and Bree Gutierrez, for Sharon Hiles, and for Susan Gilhooley, also the church in our community, Stetson Baptist here in DeLand, and for the nations, our missionaries in France, Jeff, Stephanie and Joel Swanson. In addition, this morning, I'm going to go a little long, I apologize ahead of time. It's a big week for many of us, probably most of us. We just dropped our youngest daughter off at grad school yesterday. School starting, a new season. So I'm guessing almost everybody in here is touched either by one of their children go to school, they're a teacher, they're a parent, they're, a grandparent, many options. And so as we enter that season, I just want to pray for all of us as we change into our regular time. So if you'll please join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just praise you. Lord, you never forget us. Lord, you are always there, always knowing our needs and there for us. And so, Father, as we bring these petitions to you and these praises and thanksgivings, Lord, would you be honored and glorified, and would you continue to pour out your blessings on us as a church family? Father, we lift up Julian and Bree Gutierrez. Lord, we just thank you for bringing this family and their son, Ollie, into the IPC family and for the blessing that they are to so many of us, the gifts and the graces that you've given them. Praise you for your gifts of repentance and faith in their lives, Lord, that is evident in how they live. Lord, I pray for both of them, for Julian and Bree, as they enter a very, very busy upcoming season. Lord, for Julian, we pray for wisdom and grace in prioritizing the many roles and responsibilities he has in this coming season. First, his role as a worshiper of you and your son, Jesus. Lord, his role as husband and spiritual leader of his family. His role as a father to Ollie and the soon-to-arrive Alexander. Father, his role as a teacher to the students at Mainland High School. His role as a student while beginning his doctoral studies program this fall. And his other roles of son, brother, friend, soldier, and the list goes on, Father. Lord, just strengthen them for this season ahead. Father, I confess when I listen to his upcoming fall, it makes me tired. And so, Father, I just pray that he would love you well, that he would love his wife and children well during this time, and, Father, that you would help him to balance these many things in his life. Lord, would he not succumb to too much tiredness, to fatigue? Would you be his strength each day? And, Lord, for Bree, it sounds even more challenging to me. Lord, I pray for her wisdom and grace, with her new responsibilities as coordinator here at IPC of children's ministry. And Lord, every time I listen to her list of responsibilities, it seems to grow. So children's ministry is very broad. Lord, we pray for her as she continues to pursue and lead the Kids Hope program at George Marks, as she desires to grow that program. Lord, as she engages as the caregiver of Ollie, and Lord, as she carries Alexander, Father, in the many roles she has, a daughter, wife, mother, Lord, I just pray for both of them. Lord, that you'd use this season as not a season of barely making it by, but, Lord, as a season of great dependence upon you. Father, would they grow closer to one another? Lord, would you help them to communicate well with one another, the challenges that they have? And, Lord, would you be their leader, their guide, their hope as they move through this season? Would you bless them? Father, for Ollie, we just continue to pray that you would grow him in wisdom and in stature before you and men, encouraging and enabling Julian and Bree to teach him your precepts, to teach him the oracles of your word. Father, we pray that through the power of your Spirit, Lord, you are the one who will save him, not Julian, not Bree, not any of us. And yet, Father, you give us roles, and so we pray that you would enable us in those roles, but Lord, in the end, would your Spirit work in Ollie, that there would never be a day that he didn't know the Lord Jesus Christ. And Father, we pray the same for Alexander, who is on the way. We pray for healthy birth. We pray for a beautiful young child. We pray for joyful cries as we see you give another new life to them. Lord, we also lift up Sharon Hiles in our congregation. Father, we thank you for the blessing she's been for just... Lord, I think of her she's always present. Lord, she's always sweet. Lord, she rolls with the punches because she has you. And so we thank you, Lord, that you carry her through both great times and challenging times. Father, I pray that you would shape and give her the desires of her heart. Father, she says the desires of her heart is to stay close to you, to abide in Christ. And so, Father, We know, Lord, that you answer prayer that aligns with your will. And Father, we know that aligns with your will. So would you draw her near? Would you grow her dependence on Christ, grow her relationship with Christ? Father, would you make her bold and wise as you provide opportunities to share your gospel? Lord, you've put her in a unique occupation where she gets to listen to other people's challenges, and Lord, she gets to give wisdom and understanding and love to them. And so, Father, would you make her wise? Would you give her your wisdom? And Lord, as part of that, as really the most important part of that, would you show her the right times and the right ways to share your gospel? Father, again, it's your spirit that works, but would you give Sharon the words to encourage your lost sheep? Father, would you grant that her daughter and her granddaughter are those who she witnesses to, continues to witness to? Father, you have given her great patience with both of them, great love, just a endearing love for them. And so we pray, Lord, that you would save them. Lord, for Kylie, her granddaughter, we just thank you for new opportunities to restore relationship. Pray that you would bless those, that you would protect Kylie from unhealthy relationships, that you would draw her back into your fold. Father, you have made great promises to Kylie as a covenant child, and we just pray that you would continue to pursue her. And Father, lastly, we just thank you for your providence in bringing a long-term friend, girlfriend, back into Sharon's life who is has dementia and has no family support. Lord, we just pray you've made her a charge of Sharon's. And so I just pray, Lord, that you would give Sharon much peace and wisdom and desire to love her friend well, to share your gospel, to celebrate when her mind is clear the beauties of your gospel. Father, we lift up Susan Gilhooly. We thank you for bringing her and in various seasons her children to our family here at IPC. We thank you for Allison and how the blessing her and the grandchildren have been. Father, we pray for Susan. We thank you for your ongoing love and provision for her. Pray that you would continue to grow and to bless her and her children with a deeper abiding in Christ and growing relationships with his people. We thank you for rescuing and healing Susan from her past health challenges. Lord, it is a miracle in many ways how you have healed her, and so we thank you for that work in her life. We pray that you would give her strength and grace for each new day. Would you enable her to truly enjoy her grandchildren? Lord, for John Michael and for Daniel, that she would see your kindness and her blessings to her through them. And we just pray also for her children, for Allison and Andrew and Kevin, that you would draw them and hold them near to you. Would you bless them each with your incomparable loving kindness? And Father, we lift up really almost everybody in our congregation. Lord, as we enter a new season of school, it's kind of amazing that that's the mark, but it really is. All of our lives, in one way or another, revolve around this. And so, Father, we just, I'll start at the youngest. We thank you for the infants and the kids, Lord, that will be either re-entering or entering VPKs or preschools. Lord, you know my wife is a preschool teacher. We pray, Lord, for those preschools, Lord, that there will be opportunity for these children to grow, to hear of Christ's gospel, even at their earliest age of understanding. Father, for all the elementaries and the middles and the high schoolers out there, Lord, I just pray that you would be with them. Lord, you know that the world is so challenging, Father. It is broken. Lord, due to nothing but our own sin. But Lord, it is broken. And so as you lead our children daily into the schools, Lord, would you protect them? Would you give them confidence in you, confidence in your goodness, in your truth? Lord, for our college students, in some ways they have an even harder battle as their professors, the people over them, may be unbelievers, may even be against the faith. And so, Father, would you protect them from the evil one, protect them from lies, and Lord, would you encourage them? Father, as I told my daughter this week, you can either be a light or you can be drawn away from the light. So, Father, would you help them to be a light? Lord, would you strengthen them? Draw them near to you. And then, Lord, for the teachers and the parents in our congregation, Lord, I just pray that you would continue to be with us. Would you encourage us to continue to be close to you, Lord, not shoving it down our children's throats, but showing them the beauty of walking and abiding in Christ, that they would want it. Father, would you help us? And for the teachers, as they reengage with class plans and everything, Lord, I just pray that you would go before them. It is a monumental task and often thankless. And so, Lord, would you remind them of their great worth, of the great vocation they have chosen to teach others. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Father, we also lift up Stetson Baptist Church in our local community and the Reverend Deanne Glenn. Lord, we thank you for this church. I noticed this week that they have a new sign. And Father, it was very shiny and big and bright. And Father, it just made me think of the desire to draw more lost sheep in. And so, Father, this week I pray for them, Lord, that you would use that sign as a beacon for people to notice, to wonder if they're not going to church, why not? To wonder, what is this church thing? And to come and to hear your word preached. Father, I pray for the Reverend Glenn that you would give him clarity and truth in his preaching. Lord, would you make the congregation welcoming and loving? And Father, would you in the end bring more of your lost sheep here into land, home at Stetson Baptist? And Father, finally, we pray for Stephanie and Joel Swanson in France. Lord, it feels so far away, so different in so many ways. And Father, every time I pray for them, I am saddened by the beauty of the older churches there. Lord, your church was thriving and strong in Europe, particularly in France, at a time. And Lord, it is not now, at least from our estimation. And yet, Father, you say that you will not let your church be overcome. You will protect your church. Lord Jesus, the church is your bride. We pray for France. We pray for Stephanie and for Joel, Lord, that you would enable them to continue to faithfully share the beauty of your gospel. Lord, nothing's changed about the offer from Christ. Nothing's changed about the beauty and the effectiveness of the gospel. It is only we who have walked away. And so, Father, I pray that you would bless the work of their hands, that you would draw many back into the church in France. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please stand as we now sing El Shaddai.
Father, we are thankful. We are thankful as your people for your gifts to us. And so, Father, now as we return a portion of your good gifts to us through our tithes and offerings, we pray that you would bless it. We pray that you would use it, that your kingdom would come, and that your will would be done here on earth as it is in heaven to your honor and glory. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Yes, it is true. Only in a Presbyterian church could you listen to swing low, Sweet Chariot, and stay and remain seated. Thank you for that offertory. I'll confess, actually, one of my favorites. I do have an affinity for gospel music. A great reminder, right? That offertory reminds us that actually this is not our home, and that we are looking for a greater country where the Lord Jesus will take us as His people. We continue this morning in our study of Mark's Gospel. We're in Mark chapter 11. Our sermon text this morning is Mark chapter 11, verses 12 through 25. Let's give attention now to the reading of God's holy, inspired, and inerrant word to us as His people. On the following day, when they came from Bethany, He was hungry, and seeing in the distance a fig tree in leaf, He went to see if He could find anything on it. And when He came to it, He found nothing but leaves, for it was not the season for figs. And He said to it, "May no one ever eat fruit from you again." And His disciples heard it. And they came to Jerusalem, and he entered the temple and began to drive out those who sold and those who bought in the temple. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold pigeons. And he would not allow anyone to carry anything through the temple. And he was teaching them and saying to them, "Is it not written, 'My house shall be called a house of prayer for all the nations,' but you have made it a den of robbers?" And the chief priests and the scribes heard it and were seeking a way to destroy him, for they feared him, because all the crowds was astonished at his teaching. And when evening came, they went out of the city. As they passed by in the morning, they saw the fig tree withered away at its roots. And Peter remembered and said to him, "Rabbi, look, the fig tree that you cursed has withered." And Jesus answered them, "Have faith in God. Truly I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, 'Be taken up and thrown into the sea,' and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that what he says will come to pass, it will be done for him. Therefore I tell you, whatever you ask in prayer, believe that you will receive it, and it will be yours. And whenever you stand praying, forgive, if you have anything against anyone, so that your Father also, who is in heaven, may forgive you your trespasses." Give us understanding. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. And now we ask as your people, and I ask as one who preaches this morning, that you would give us great humility under your word. Would you teach us? Would you instruct us? Would you train us? And by your grace, would you save us through the proclamation of your word? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'll use a term this morning that sometimes, particularly in our culture, is unpopular, and that's the term religion. Yet biblically, if you went to the book of James, you would see that the word religion has a twofold connotation. There is what James calls pure religion, that which is in keeping with God's word, and unworthy religion. Religion that is true and religion that is false. Fig Newtons. You either love them or you hate them. A Fig Newton is a cookie bar or a pastry roll. It's chewy, sticky, and has a flaky crust on the outside. It's your healthy cookie alternative. Today's sermon is a fig sandwich. Right, our passage today, Mark has organized the structure of his gospel narrative so that Jesus' cleansing of the temple is sandwiched between lessons from a fig tree. Mark's structure, which is also under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, helps us to quickly resolve the conflict and the criticism that comes with this text. Perhaps like the herd of swine that plunged to death in the ocean in Mark 5 as Jesus heals the Gerasene demoniac, some critics view the cursing of the fig tree as an unfair and unjust treatment of the tree. After all, it was not fruitful because it was not the season for figs, our text tells us. Some critics view the destruction of the tree as an unkind act, the misuse of divine power, thus proving that Jesus is not the Son of God. Some use this passage as an example of the lack of the reliability of the Bible, as they believe the fig tree narrative was added to scriptures. First, all of these objections and critiques start with a similar premise. God's word is faulty. Let me go find fault. Although there are many, and I mean many, if you read commentaries, elaborate textual and agricultural explanations that some scholars have put forth to answer some of these criticisms, in truth, I think, as we will see, the context and the purpose of these events answer these critiques. Jesus is using the fig tree as an object lesson. It's a visible parable. In the Old Testament, we should have heard the word fig tree, and all of a sudden it should have conjured up images for us of Israel, because God describes Israel as a fig tree. When Israel walked obediently and faithfully in the ways of the Lord, she would be a fruitful tree. She's not often described that way. When Israel walked unfaithfully, not in the ways of the Lord, she would be a fruitless or a vile fig tree. Listen to Hosea 9, verse 10. Like the grapes in the wilderness, I found Israel. Like the first fruits on the fig tree in its first season, I saw your fathers. But they came to Baal Peor and consecrated themselves to the things of shame and became detestable like the things they loved. God's judgment is seen in the fig tree in Joel 1, verse 7 and verse 12. He says, and it has laid to waste my vine and splintered my fig tree. Verse 12, the vine dries up and the fig tree languishes, describing his relationship with Israel and his judgment over her. Jesus chose the fig tree on the path to Jerusalem, to the temple, to teach the disciples and us about the sinful corruption of God's people, Israel. Through the leaf, the lack of fruit, and the withering of the fig tree, Jesus is revealing God's pending judgment against Israel due to her rotten spiritual condition. Israel is corrupt because the hearts of her leaders and the hearts of her people are rotten. They are hard and sinful. Israel needs redemption. Israel needs a new spiritual heart, a heart that loves God and is faithful to all of God's commands and purposes. This is our need as well. We need a new heart. Like God's people Israel, we have left true and pure religion and pursued false religion. God is the center. God is the object. God is the enabler of pure and true religion. God's glory and God's grace are the only means to bring us to God. True religion leads us to repentance and faith in God. Unworthy, false religion rests on us. False religion is based on the performance of man. False religion loves its traditions, as Jesus taught in Mark chapter 7. It loves appearance, but forsakes the commands of God. So let us consider lessons from the fig tree this morning under two primary headings. One, rotten figs, and the other, good figs. Pure religion, true religion, and false religion. Rotten figs. Rotten figs have three characteristics in our text this morning. They are deceptive, they're distorted, and they're dead. Look at deception, verses 12 through 14. Last week, as we began in Mark 11, Jesus arrived in Jerusalem for Passover. This is his final journey to Jerusalem. As he has predicted, his death dawns near. Jesus has been royally greeted as he entered Jerusalem. He entered the city riding on a colt, a path of honor in front of him, covered with cloaks and branches. In addition, we still hear the echoes of the crowd singing hallelujah, praise to his name. He is the Son of David. Jesus is the promised Davidic king who will reign and rule over God's people and fulfill God's promises to David that a son would reign on the throne. From the triumphal entry, Mark tells us that Jesus went to the temple and looked around before retiring to Bethany, a nearby town where Jesus and his disciples spent the night, probably in the home of Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. for the Passover celebration. It appears that Jesus and the disciples are commuting each day to and from Bethany. As they begin their morning commute to the temple in Jerusalem, Jesus is hungry. He observes a fig tree along the road that appears to be fruitful, despite it not being the season for figs. Jesus goes over. Jesus inspects the tree and finds out that not only are there no figs, there are no buds or the promise of fruitfulness of any kind. The leaves on the fig tree had given the appearance of fruitfulness, but a closer look revealed that the fig tree was without figs or the promise of figs. So Jesus declares that the tree will never be fruitful again. The leaf and the appearance of the fig tree was a deception. False religion always gives the appearance of fruitfulness. But upon inspection, there are no figs. There is no fruit. There is no righteousness. There is no holiness. They are missing. Historians agree that Herod's temple in Jerusalem in the days of Jesus was spectacular. It was a building with no equal. It was considered a wonder of the world. Its appearance was glorious, but as we will see, it deceptively boasted of great worship and allegiance to the God of Israel. I love a piece of good fruit, do you not? The crunch and the taste of good apple are mouth-watering. The juicy explosion in your mouth of a good peach leaves you slurping for more. But as satisfying as a good apple or a peach can be, they are horrifying if they're mealy. A mushy apple, a mushy peach may look good on the outside. That's why you take a bite of it. But on the inside, they are rotting. On the outside, they appear to be good, but they are deceivers. You see, appearances can be deceiving, can they not? On the surface, from the distance, the fig tree looked to be fruitful, but it was not. Israel's house of worship, the temple, was beautiful. It appeared to be in order, but Jesus will reveal that within it was rotten, mushy, and mealy. How about us? If I'm honest, I work hard to keep up appearances. I pretend like everything in my life is in order or choose carefully what I allow others to see. My fig tree has green leaves, even if I have to tape them on. But where is the fruit? I talk about Jesus, God's grace and redemption, but I am often dutifully going through the motions, seeking to earn at least my sanctification. On the surface, I profess true religion, but are the fruits of saving faith, prayer, and the grace of forgiveness present in my life? How about you? Distortion. Look at 15 through 19. With the object lesson of the fig tree in mind, Jesus arrives at the temple. The Passover season was in full swing. On the surface, all that was needed to fulfill the law of God was at hand. Jewish travelers from across the Roman Empire were arriving into Jerusalem for the Passover feast. They needed to exchange currency to be able to pay the temple tax. Currency exchange was necessary, but it was also a profitable business. Since traveling with animals to fulfill the sacrificial requirements of the law of God was inconvenient, you could purchase animals for sacrifice. One historian recorded that during the Passover season in AD 65, 250,000 lambs were sacrificed at the temple during Passover. Temple commerce was big business. Jesus arrived at the temple to find a bazaar filled with money changers, animals, spices, and all that was needed for the sacrificial system of worship. And it crowded the temple. The Mount of Olives, which Jesus and His disciples had descended on the morning, journeying from Bethany to the temple, was usually where the commerce of the temple took place. The temple and her four courts were holy, were consecrated to the worship of God. So as Jesus enters the outer court, the court of the Gentiles, He finds not only temple commerce set up in the courtyard, but its court had become a pathway, a shortcut through the city. Instead of walking around the temple, people were walking through it. It had become a common street, a place of business. With righteous indignation, with zeal and love for His Father, to reveal the fruit of unrighteousness that was rotting the temple court, the call of God's people Israel to repentance and faith and true religion in Himself, Jesus does what? He cleans house. He drives out animals and their merchants. He overturns tables of the money changers, the chairs of pigeon salesmen. Pigeons were being sold to the poor. The sacrificial system, a pigeon was the animal sacrifice reserved for those who could not afford a lamb. The temple was beautiful. On the surface, God's people were engaging in their religious duties. They had traveled to Jerusalem. They were tithing their temple tax. They were making sacrifice for their sins and purification. They were performing their religious duties. But as Jesus is clearing out the temple, He is revealing the lack of fruit. Beneath their religious piety is nothing but rotten figs. The temple is divided into four courts. Each court is separated by a wall. The innermost court, the Holy of Holies, where God dwells. The court of the Jews was next, the court of women next, and then the outer court, the court of the Gentiles. The court of the Gentiles was to be a place where the nations was to be a place where people from every nation could come, would come to discover, would come to worship the one true God, the God of Israel. It was a court consecrated for prayer and seeking after God. God's covenant with Abraham, remember, was to bless him, to make him a blessing to the nations. The temple in Jerusalem was the dwelling place of God. It was to be the light to the nations. As the prophet Isaiah reminds God's people in Isaiah 56, 6 through 8, as he says, "And the foreigners who join themselves to the Lord, to minister to Him, to love the name of the Lord, to be His servants, everyone who keeps the Sabbath and does not profane it and holds to My covenant, these will I bring to My holy mountain and make them joyful in the house of prayer. Their burnt offerings, their sacrifices will be acceptable on My altar. For My house shall be called a house of prayer for all peoples. The Lord God who gathers the outcast of Israel declares, I will gather yet others to Him besides those already gathered." God's people, His elect, were never intended to be from the nation of Israel alone. Israel, through her worship and obedience to the Lord and His Word, were to be the witnesses to the nations. The fame of God, of the God of Israel, was to be made known among all the nations. People would come to Jerusalem to see, to learn more about the one true and only God. As people from every nation came to Jerusalem and by faith let go of false religion and clung by faith and obedience to the name of the Lord, they were brought into the holy mountain, filled with joy and their sacrifices made acceptable to God. As Jesus inspects the fruit of worship in the temple, it is rotting in the outer court. The witness of the temple, the witness of God's people, was being distorted by the merchants, by the commerce present inside the temple court. They'd long forgotten their purpose. They'd long forgotten their witness to the nations. They had pushed the Gentiles out. So Jesus cleans house because false religion distorts the purposes of God. God's dwelling place had become a den of robbers, exploiting worshipers for personal gain and greed. So rotten was the fruit that the court of the Gentiles was no longer holy, no longer set apart to welcome a welcome witness to the nations, no longer the house of prayer it was consecrated to be. As Jesus cleans house, the crowds are amazed. The religious leaders are afraid. The crowds are amazed today, and yet soon they will cry out, "Crucify him." They're attracted to his teaching, but they're not changed by its content. The fear of the religious leaders does not lead to the fruit of repentance in their lives, but it leads to a deepening desire to destroy Jesus. Notice that Jesus is not condemned even by the religious leaders for his actions, for they know that according to the law of God, they had distorted the use of the temple for their own personal gain. So rotten had their hearts become. How about us? If Jesus were to walk into our sanctuary this morning, if we were to participate in our ministry as a church, what would he find? Would he find hearts that are filled with faith in God, or hands filled with traditions and religious duties? Would he find a repentant heart that weeps over our sin and looks to Jesus for our pardon and perfection, or simply a heart pretending to be righteous and keeping up the appearance of piety? O Church of God, are we distorting God's purpose? Is Emmanuel a place where the gospel of Jesus Christ is proclaimed in word and deed? Are all people welcome here? Do we desire that our neighbors, yes, our sinful neighbors, would come and behold the wonders of our great God, come and behold the wonders of His grace, find life in His name? This is one reason we gather to worship each Sunday. Are we a house of prayer for the nations? Are we, am I, praying for the nations? Praying for my neighbors, praying for my friends, praying for my co-workers, praying for my children. Am I even praying, or are we even praying for our enemies? Are we praying that God would bring them to saving faith in His Son Jesus, and even graciously use us in the process? If God were to clear the obstacles to faith that we put in the way of others, what would He overturn and what would He drive out of our lives? Rotten figs are deceptive. Rotten figs distort God's purposes, and God judges them as being dead. Look at verses 20 and 21. Jesus and his disciples leave the temple courts and commute back to Bethany by evening light. They awake the next morning to return to the temple. Jesus had much more teaching to do in the temple courts, as we'll see and discover next week. As they pass by the fig tree, Peter, spokesman for the 12, right, makes an amazing observation that the fig tree that Jesus cursed has withered. The withering and the dead fig tree foreshadows God's certain and sure judgment against Israel and her rotten worship. As Jesus foretells through the other gospel writers, the temple will be destroyed, and her false worship of appearances, her false worship of performance, and her love for traditions over her love for God are to be judged ineffectual and not acceptable before a holy God. And they will be not acceptable forever, because they're dead. Look at verses 22 through 24, good figs. Responding to Peter's observation of the dead figs, Jesus reveals, right, and contrasts the difference between good figs and rotten figs, true religion and false religion. First and foremost, God is the author and object of saving faith. Have faith in God. Have faith in God and not your appearance. Have faith in God and not your acts of piety, your good works. Have faith in God, not in yourself or in someone or in something else. Have faith in God. As Jesus and his disciples are traveling from Bethany to Jerusalem, the Dead Sea is visible from the Mount of Olives. So Jesus, again, is painting for them a picture of what saving faith looks like. Have faith in God. What does that look like? Saving faith? Faith rests on God alone. It knows that God is sovereign. It knows that God is all-powerful. And thus, we can trust what God can do and God can do alone with unwavering doubt. So if I say to this mountain, the Mount of Olives, be thrown into the Dead Sea, right? The all-powerful God is able to do that. That is who is the object of our faith. A good fig tree is rooted by faith in God. It is also rooted by faith in His purposes. The good fig tree produces good figs, the good figs of prayer and forgiveness. Note the contrast. Jesus finds no faith in God at the temple, only the appearance of it. The rotten fruits of failing faith and false religion, religious actions that Jesus overturned are condemned as prayerless because they're prayerless for the nations, an ungracious and unforgiving mindset. Because what? They are blocking the court of the Gentiles to block access that the nations would know about God. So we begin to see here that good figs of prayer and forgiveness are produced by a heart turned to God by repentance and faith. In keeping with Jesus' teaching on the Lord's Prayer, He reminds His disciples that faith in God will lead us to ask. We are instructed to ask God and to trust and to believe and to await His answer and provision. In addition to prayer, the grace of forgiveness is a good fruit of faith in God. Our desire and our ability to forgive others or to ask for forgiveness from others are fruits that flow from a root of a heart that has been forgiven by God. When by repentance and faith in Jesus we have been forgiven of our past, present, and future sins, we're free to forgive others and graciously ask them to forgive us. You see, our unity and our community as Christ people demonstrate to a watching world the reality and the power of the gospel. Good figs are from faith. They produce the sweet fruit of prayer and forgiveness. How about us? Have we come to understand that all our religious activities, apart from faith in Jesus Christ, are dead? Are the good figs of prayer and forgiveness present in our lives? Does God's grace overflow from us into our relationships? Are we quick to forgive others as we have been forgiven by the Lord Jesus Christ? Or are we no different than the world around us that is prone to hold grudges and withhold love from one another? In conclusion, I want us to simply see two things. I want us to see the heart of Jesus. I want us to see that Jesus is angered and righteously angered in the temple because access to the gospel is being blockaded. He cares that all would hear, that all would know, that all would be able to come and hear the good news that He brings in and of Himself. Good news that He will usher all into the Holy of Holies as He will fulfill all that the righteous law demands and all of the sacrifice needed for our sins. want us to ask the questions of ourselves. Are we a people of pure religion, or are we a people of false religion? Do we care more about appearances than we do about the good works of faith, the good work of prayer, and the good work of forgiveness that are ours in the gospel of Christ Jesus? Let us pray. Father, thank you for your word. And Father, a word that should require us this morning as your people to evaluate. So as we sit under the lipness of your word, would you help us to consider, Father, who is the object of our faith? Are we resting in the work of Christ? Do we have faith in God? Or are we looking to someone or something else? Father, help us to rest in Jesus and Jesus alone. Whether it's for the first time or our ongoing need by repentance and faith of the work of Christ as His children. Father, help us to evaluate our lives, and that you would help us to see the areas where there is where we put up obstacles to the gospel for others. Help us to remove those. Help us to have the heart of our Redeemer that proclaims the good news of His gospel to all who will hear. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Please stand as we sing Christ the Sure and Steady Anchor.
Thank you.
you so much for your presence with us this morning. If you have questions, if you'd like to know more about the gospel of Jesus Christ, I would love to engage that conversation with you or schedule a time to do so. I'll be in the breezeway, would love to greet you and talk or schedule a time to have a conversation about the great hope that I have in Christ Jesus. But you know, the person next to you would also love to tell you about the hope they have in Christ. So let's encourage one another through those conversations this morning. Receive the benediction now. Now to Him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to Him, to Jesus, be glory in the church and in Jesus Christ throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Go in peace.